Well, good evening everybody to St Michael's and welcome to tonight's Evensong service. It's really good to see so many people up here this evening on the tour. And welcome of course to those of you who are joining us online. In case you don't already know, my name's Wendy and I'm part of the ministry team in the benefice. So we will be following the order of service in the black book beginning on page 72. And before we begin, let's just take a couple of minutes just to still ourselves as we come before the living God in worship. Some words from Scripture. May God be gracious to us and bless us and make his face to shine upon us. Let's stand together and sing our first hymn this evening, hymn number 287. The scripture moveth us in sundry places to acknowledge and confess our manifold sins and wickedness, and that we should not dissemble nor cloak them before the face of Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, but confess them with a humble, lowly, penitent and obedient heart, to the end that we may obtain forgiveness of the same by his infinite goodness and mercy. And although we ought at all times humbly to acknowledge our sins before God, yet ought we most chiefly so to do when we assemble and meet together, to render thanks for the great benefits that we have received at his hands, to set forth his most worthy praise, to hear his most holy word, and to ask those things which are requisite and necessary as well for the body as the soul. Wherefore I pray and beseech you, as many as are here present, to accompany me with a pure heart and humble voice unto the throne of the heavenly grace, saying after me.
Almighty and merciful Father, we have erred and strayed from thy ways like lost sheep. We have followed too much the devices and desires of our own hearts. We have offended against thy holy laws. We have left undone those things which we ought to have done. And we have done those things which we ought not to have done. And there is no health in us. But thou, O Lord, have mercy upon us, miserable offenders. Spare thou them, O God, which confess their faults. Restore thou them that are penitent, according to thy promises, declared unto mankind, in Christ Jesus our Lord. And grant, O most merciful Father, for his sake, that we may hereafter live a godly, righteous, and sober life, to the glory of thy holy name.
Grant, we beseech thee, merciful Lord, to thy faithful people pardon and peace, that we may be cleansed of all our sins and serve thee with a quiet mind through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Amen. We pray. Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, in earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive them that trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen.
And our mouths shall show forth thy praise.
O God, make speed to save us.
O Lord, make haste to help us.
Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Ghost.
As it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall.
And this can be found on our pew sheets this evening. And I'd be grateful if you would read the words in bold. May God be gracious to us and bless us, and make his face shine upon us.
That your way may be known upon earth, your saving power among all nations.
Let the peoples praise you, O God. Let all the people praise you.
Let the nations be glad and sing for joy, for you judge the peoples with equity and guide the nations upon earth.
Let the people praise you, O God. Let all the people praise you.
The earth has yielded its increase. God, our God, has blessed us.
May God continue to bless us. Let all the ends of the earth revere him. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Ghost, as it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. Amen.
The Old Testament reading is taken from the first book of Kings, chapter 2, verses 10 to 12, and chapter 3. Verses 16 to 28. Then David slept with his ancestors and was buried in the city of David. The time that David reigned over Israel was 40 years. He reigned for 7 years in Hebron and 33 years in Jerusalem. So Solomon sat on the throne of his father David, and his kingdom was firmly established. Later, two women who were prostitutes came to the king and stood before him. One woman said, "Please, my lord, this woman and I live in the same house, and I gave birth while she was in the house. Then on the third day after I gave birth, this woman also gave birth. We were together. There was no one else with us in the house. Only the two of us were in the house. Then this woman's son died in the night because she lay on him. She got up in the middle of the night and took my son from beside me while your servant slept. She laid him at her breast and laid her dead son at my breast. When I rose in the morning to nurse my son, I saw that he was dead. But when I looked at him closely in the morning, clearly it was not the son I had borne. But the other woman said, 'No, the living son is mine, and the dead son is yours.' The first said, 'No, the dead son is yours, and the living son is mine.' So they argued before the king. Then the king said, 'One says, this is my son that is alive, and your son is dead, while the other says, not so. Your son is dead, and my son is the living one.' So the king said, 'Bring me a sword.' And they brought a sword before the king. The king said, 'Divide the living boy in two, then give half to one and half to the other.' But the woman whose son was alive said to the king, because compassion for her son burned within her, 'Please, my lord, give her the living boy. Certainly do not kill him.' The other said, 'It shall be neither mine nor yours. Divide it.' Then the king responded, 'Give the first woman the living boy. Do not kill him. She is his mother.' All Israel heard of the judgment that the king had rendered, and they stood in awe of the king, because they perceived that the wisdom of God was in him to execute justice." This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Let us stand and say the words of the Magnificat together. My soul doth magnify the Lord,
and my spirit hath rejoiced in God my Saviour. For he hath regarded the lowliness of his handmaiden. For behold, from henceforth all generations shall call me blessed. For he that is mighty hath magnified me, and holy is his name. And his mercy is on them that fear him throughout all generations. He hath showed strength with his arm. He hath scattered the proud in the imagination of their hearts. He hath put down the mighty from their seat, and hath exalted the humble and the meek. He hath filled the hungry with good things, and the rich he hath sent empty away. He, remembering his mercy, hath opened his servant Israel, as he promised to our forefathers, Abraham and his seed forever. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Ghost, as it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. Amen.
Please be seated as Christopher reads our New Testament text this evening.
The New Testament reading is taken from the book of Acts, chapter 4, beginning at the first verse. While Peter and John were speaking to the people, the priests, the captain of the temple, and the Sadducees came to them, much annoyed because they were teaching the people and proclaiming that in Jesus there is the resurrection of the dead. So they arrested them and put them in custody until the next day, for it was already evening. But many of those who heard the word believed, and they numbered about 5,000. The next day, their rulers, elders and scribes assembled in Jerusalem with Annas the high priest, Caiaphas, John and Alexander, and all who were of the high priestly family. When they had made the prisoners stand in their midst, they inquired, "By what power or by what name did you do this?" Then Peter, filled with the Holy Spirit, said to them, "Rulers of the people and elders, if we are questioned today because of a good deed done to someone who was sick, and are asked how this man has been healed, let it be known to all of you, to all the people of Israel, that this man is standing before you in good health by the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, whom you crucified, whom God raised from the dead. This Jesus is the stone that was rejected by you, the builders, and it has become the cornerstone. There is salvation in no one else, for there is no other name under heaven given among mortals by which we must be saved." Now, when they saw the boldness of Peter and John, and realized that they were uneducated and ordinary men, they were amazed and recognized them as companions of Jesus. When they saw the man who had been cured standing beside them, they had nothing to say in opposition. So they ordered them to leave the council while they discussed the matter with one another. They said, "What will we do with them? For it is obvious to all who live in Jerusalem that a notable sign has been done through them. We cannot deny it. But to keep it from spreading further among the people, let us warn them to speak no more to anyone in his name." So they called them and ordered them not to speak or teach at all in the name of Jesus. But Peter and John answered them, "Whether it is right in God's sight to listen to you rather than to God, you must judge. For we cannot keep from speaking about what we have seen and heard." After threatening them again, they let them go, finding no way to punish them because of the people. For all of them praised God for what had happened. For the man on whom this sign of healing had been performed was more than 40 years old. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Well, God's glory is seen, I think, especially at St. Michael's at this time of year. In the flowers, beautifully provided by Robin. In our canine friends here, who are obviously enjoying the service so far. And of course, in the swallows twittering away in the porch. So let's stand and say the words of the Nunc Dimittis on page 77 of the Black Book together. Lord, now lettest thou thy servants depart in peace, according to thy word. For mine eyes have seen thy salvation, which thou hast prepared before the face of all people, to be a light to lighten the Gentiles, and to be the glory of thy people Israel. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Ghost, as it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. Amen. And we remain standing as we profess our faith. We say together,
I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead and buried. he descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven, and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with thy spirit.
Let us pray. Lord, have mercy upon us.
Christ, have mercy upon us.
Lord, have mercy upon us.
Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, in earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive them that trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil.
Amen. May be set to obey thy commandments, and also that by thee we, being defended from the fear of our enemies, may pass our time in rest and quietness through the merits of Jesus Christ, our Saviour.
Amen.
And we say together,
Lighten our darkness, we beseech thee, O Lord, and by thy great mercy defend us from all perils and dangers of this night. For the love of thy only Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ.
Amen. We stand and we sing hymn number 721.
Jesus, thou art all glory.
I speak in the name of God, the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. Our Old Testament evening, reading this evening involves King Solomon arbitrating in a dispute between two women over a child. But before we actually consider the text, let's recap what we actually know about Solomon. To begin with, he was born in approximately 990 BC and became king of Israel round about 970 BC. His father was David and his mother
Bathsheba.
There you go. And it's interesting, when he became king, by his own admission, he felt as a small child when faced with overwhelming responsibilities of leadership. So what does he do? Well, he goes before God in worship. And God appeared to Solomon in a dream, saying, "Ask what I should give you." And Solomon replied, "Give your servant an understanding mind to govern your people and the ability to discern between good and evil." He could have asked for anything, couldn't he? And God said to him, "Because you have asked this and not asked for yourself long life or riches, or for the life of your enemies, but have asked for yourself understanding to discern what is right, I now give you a wise and discerning mind." In tonight's text, we see Solomon put that wise and discerning mind to good use as he recognizes the true love of a mother for her child. In the book of Proverbs in the Bible, we read, "Those who trust in their own wits are fools, but those who walk in wisdom come through safely." Wisdom. What exactly is it? I wonder how you would define the word. I read somewhere that the word wisdom appears 367 times in the Bible across 28 books. And from this, I guess we can deduce that the Bible is saturated in talk of wisdom, how to achieve it, and even where to find it. And I'm reminded of a story of two teachers who applied for the same deputy head position at a secondary school. No names. One had been teaching for a total of 8 years, the other for 20. Everyone expected the teacher with the greater number of years in service to get the job. But it was actually the other who was appointed. And the teacher who was not appointed complained bitterly, "I've got 20 years teaching to her 8. I'm vastly more qualified." And the response from the chair of governors? "Yes, you have 20 years teaching to her 8. But whereas she has 8 years experience, you have 1 year's experience repeated 20 times." You see, it does not always follow that simply experiencing the passage of time leads to growth or to wisdom. We live, don't we, in an information-rich society. So much so that we may sometimes feel that we are suffering from information overload, Do you ever feel like that?
Yes.
I know I do. I can see lots of you nodding. A century and a half ago, it took news 3 weeks to travel across the Atlantic from England to America. Today, we turn on a television and we see news happening in real time, literally anywhere in the world, almost. There is more information in one Sunday edition of the Telegraph or Guardian newspaper than a person in the Middle Ages was exposed to during their entire lifetime. And yet, I get a sense that all of our technological and scientific knowledge, all of our limitless access to information, hasn't made us that much wiser as a species. The fact that we have war in Europe once more testifies to this. The fact that global warming is on the increase testifies to this, don't you think? The story of Solomon's judgment reminds us that right and wrong are real. Good and evil exist, and we need wisdom to discern the difference between right and wrong, good and evil. When God gave Solomon the gift of wisdom, he said to Solomon, "If you will walk in my ways, keeping my statutes and my commandments, then I will lengthen your life." And it is in knowing God, in following God's ways, that Solomon acquires wisdom, and he actually ruled for over 40 years. He was wise enough to understand a mother's love. He discerns that the real mother would surrender her son rather than allow a hair on his head to be harmed. Now, like Solomon, we can be confronted with situations where maybe right and wrong are not always obvious, where good and evil are not always clear. In such times, like Solomon, we need to trust in God for discernment. Pray, look to the scriptures for guidance, and listen for God's word. Our New Testament reading has John and Peter proclaiming Christ to be the cornerstone of their lives. In him, and only in him, do they trust before taking action. You know, my daughter, when she was young, along with a number of her friends, would wear a woven bracelet. You may have worn a similar one on her right wrist with the letters WWJD sewn into it. WWJD? What would Jesus do? It reminded her to focus on Christ, the living word, before taking action, before responding in situations. I think we can often learn much from the example of children and young people, don't you? So to end with, ask yourself this: whose wisdom are you trusting in and day out? Your own? Some self-help gurus? Another man or woman's, whose knowledge is limited when compared with God, and whose judgments are fallible? The message is clear, I think, from this evening's readings. Trust in God, the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit in their infinite wisdom. Now, our final hymn this evening says it all. Guide me, O thou great Redeemer. We look to God to guide us. And when we come to singing this, let's do so with gusto, like I remember doing so in those valley churches where I grew up. Let us remember to centre our lives on God, to have Christ as our cornerstone. God loves you and me just as we are. And let's remember to praise God for God's infinite love for us. Amen.
Dear Lord, this night we come before you and pray that the way in which we live would reflect our Christian calling and work with our family and friends, the way we spend our money and all the different parts of our lives. May our fellowship with one another be an occasion in which we are encouraged and equipped to make a difference in our world. Give us courage to be bold in our witness to the good news of the gospel. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We pray for the worldwide church, and especially those in the Diocese of Exeter and its partner Diocese of Cyprus and the Gulf. As your people gather together today, this evening, now, and on holy days all around the world, may they feel your presence and grow closer to you. May we who are your church know your love and reach out to others. As you have welcomed us, may we welcome others. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We pray this evening for all those children and students and teachers and teaching assistants, everyone, all the lecturers whose schools and universities have broken up for the summer holiday. Grant them all a restful and enjoyable summer. We pray for everyone on holiday, especially those whose long-awaited time away has been disrupted by the weather, in the heat and fires of the Mediterranean and the heavy rains here at home. And we pray for your protection, Lord, on all those families who are in crisis and whose summer is anything but a holiday. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Lord God, we pray for peace in the world, especially in those areas torn with war and strife. We especially remember the people of Ukraine, South Sudan, Yemen, Central African Republic, Syria, Iraq, so many places. We also bring before you the people of Russia and all those other reluctant conscripts caught up in wars and carnage they did not choose. Lord God, grant to this world peace and justice. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Lord, we trust in your promises that you know us and understand our need. So we bring before you those things which worry us, knowing that you're with us no matter what. We pray today for those who are facing or undergoing medical treatment, who are fearful of test results, who are sick and long to be well. Be their companion, guard, protect them, and give them your healing touch. We pray for those who have asked for our prayers, for Lynn, Peter and Carol, Dave, Becky, Shirley, Sandra, Val, Steve, Zach, Diana, Harry, Cheryl, Ali, Pam and Den, Aidan, Sandra, Lillian, Archie, Vicky, Maureen, Gary, and John. And we take a moment now to name in our hearts others known to us and to you who are suffering. And as is our custom in this place, these are the prayers that have been left for us. For my Nan, who passed away last week. Lots of love, Bex. For my great aunt Tina with cancer, and my Nana and grandfather who are gone. And one in German from, I think it's the Jaspers. I don't know what it says, but God knows. For my good friend, Joseph Richard Eustace, who is going through a tough time right now with his personal life. May the Lord guide him in his tough journey. And to finish, please pray for everyone who is struggling with life. So those are the prayers that were left to be said today. We bring them all before you, Lord. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
And Lord God, for ourselves, we pray you will set our hearts not on the temporary things of this world, that we might live in awareness of your heavenly kingdom where we all belong. And we remember those who have gone before us, all those we have loved, and we pray that we with them might be united in the joy of your presence, knowing that the light of Christ shines on us all and brings us hope. Merciful Father,
accept these prayers. For the sake of your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Stand and sing the good Welsh number to end with. Guide me, O thou great Redeemer. I love this.
Thank you.
my grandfather would have approved of that rendition. God loves us. Let's remember this as we leave this special place this evening, and let's be the love of Christ in our communities. Let's end with a grace together, shall we?
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit, be with us all, evermore. Amen.
Thank you so much for joining us this evening, and Helen will just give our notices. Please be seated, and can I thank you for coming and wish you a safe journey home later. Helen, thank you.
Next weekend, we have a couple of special services. On the Saturday at 2 o'clock down in Christchurch, we have the memorial service for Anne Clark, who was a very great stalwart of the church, and until she was about 85 or 86, still did the flowers up here. So a splendid lady, Anne, and her memorial service is next Saturday afternoon at 2 o'clock. While on the Sunday, we have another special service, and that is a pilgrimage service for the Archangel Way, 6 o'clock here next Sunday, and the well-known folk singer Jim Causley will be here, and he will be singing his song that he wrote specially for it, The Archangel Way. So that is a pilgrimage service here next Sunday at 6 o'clock. And there are lots of other things coming up later on, but no time now. Lovely to see you all. Thank you.
Lovely to see everybody, honestly. Lovely to see everyone.